I'm Richard Wolinsky, and this is the new Bookwaves Artwaves Hour. Interviews with writers on KPFA's nationally syndicated Bookwaves program, along with interviews about film and theater, and archive book interviews that stretch back four decades. Coming up today are first an interview with author Salman Rushdie about his latest novel, Quichotte, followed by an interview with playwright Ricardo Perez Gonzales, whose latest work, Don't Eat the Mangoes, is now playing at the Magic Theater in San Francisco. But first, the Bookwaves portion of the program. My guest is Salman Rushdie, whose latest novel is Quichotte. That's Quichotte. Earlier novels are 15 previous novels, Midnight's Children, Golden House, Shalimar the Clown, several others. There are four works of nonfiction, including the memoir Joseph Anton. This particular book takes off a little bit on Cervantes' Don Quixote, and I understand that you began thinking about this when you were listening to an opera. Is that correct?
Well, it came out of a couple of things. Yeah, one was that I'd listened to the 19th century French opera by Jules Massenet, which is called Don Quichotte in the French pronunciation. And that made me start thinking about Cervantes. And also there was an anniversary, about 4 years ago, which was about when I listened to this opera. It was the 400th anniversary of Cervantes. So I was asked to write something about him. And that meant that I picked up the book, the great book, which I hadn't done in, I don't know, since I was at college. And it got me thinking, because I had been thinking about a road novel anyway. It sort of reminded me of the granddaddy of all road novels, and that became a starting place.
Did the road novel begin because you were thinking about what was happening in America today?
Yeah, also that I felt that in the previous two novels, I had essentially almost entirely stayed inside New York City, and that I wanted to get out of the city. I wanted to go across America. And in fact, I at one point thought that it might not be a novel, that it might be an actual journey that I would take with my son and see what happened to us. But in the end, I just reverted to my kind of A game and thought I'll make it up instead.
Did you do any kind of travel?
Quite a lot of these are places that over the course of the last 20 years I have visited to some extent. There are one or two places in the book which are sort of fictional towns which are quite like real places. There's not a town in New Jersey called Beringer where people turn into mastodons. There's not a town in Kansas called Beautiful, but there are places like that, very like that. So I felt that over the last couple of decades, I'd seen enough of America to make it possible for me to do this journey as an act of imagination rather than as a kind of literal journey.
We'll get to both Beautiful and Beringer in a little bit, but when you finally decided you were going to do this, there are a couple of hints, obviously the name, toward Don Quixote, but it's also more a general kind of satire on culture and politics as the original was. When you were looking at writing the road novel, what made you decide to actually tell two stories, the story of Quichotte and then the story of the writer writing Quichotte?
Yeah, well, that happened, really took me by surprise in a way, because I was not planning to do it. I mean, I had thought that the book I would write would be about two sorts of journey. One is the physical journey across America, which would have a look at what's going on in the country. And the other would be a kind of inner journey, if you like, that Quichotte takes in order to, as he says, make himself worthy of the hand of this famous woman that he's decided he's in love with and who he doesn't know. So he sets himself a series of tests in a kind of almost allegorical way. So there are those two journeys, and that the inner journey and the outer journey, which I thought that was the book. And then I found myself writing this other material about the ostensible author of the Quichotte storyline. Truthfully, I've always slightly disapproved of that kind of fiction, the kind of books in which a writer writes about a writer writing a book. And I've always thought, don't do that sort of thing. And then I found myself doing it. And I was very uncertain about whether it should stay in the book. And I just thought, I'm going to see what there is here. And I reserved with myself the right to take it out. But then I found that the story of the ostensible author who calls himself Brother uses the pseudonym of Sam Duchamp and is a kind of second-rate spy novelist who's trying something different. Trying something different, he realizes rather quickly that he's in fact telling his own story, and he's writing something which is probably more intimately his own story than anything he's done. And his own life problems are worked out through the story of Quichotte. He has a son that he's estranged from, that he wants to mend fences with. He has a sister that he believes he's done her wrong in the past, and he wants to see if reconciliation and forgiveness are possible. In the Quichotte storyline, there are variations on both those themes, and those are very much like, in a way, the kind of emotional heart of the book, I think. And they don't all end the same way. Some of them end better than others. But then I thought, actually, I quite like the way these storylines are illuminating one another. And I think, you know, I'll keep them. I'll keep them both.
For you, Salman Rushdie, is there a parallel, not necessarily in this book, but in other books, where you, on some level, are working things out in the same way with maybe different endings as characters in your novels?
Yeah, I mean, I think quite often, and even in this book, you know, because there are things in this book in which are very personal to me. One is the fact that the theme of opioid addiction that's in the book. I mean, Quichotte starts off as a pharmaceutical salesman and is working for a person who we discover is a sort of opioid crook, a pharmaceutical entrepreneur who is getting these very powerful drugs into the hands of people who don't need them. Anyway, the reason for my interest in that was that my youngest sister became dependent on these things, on, you know, Vicodin, Percocet, Oxycontin, and 12 years ago had a heart attack and died. And I, at that time, had no idea that how seriously dependent she had become. And it shocked me deeply. And so it became personal to me. I thought, I have to find out about this stuff. And I've spent, you know, on and off in the last decade, I've been diving into this. I mean, I've been looking at, you know, the Sackler family and the Johnson & Johnson thing, and actually even the true life story on which my character in the book, Dr. Smile, is based. I've been following that story for a while. I mean, now suddenly it's in the news, and people are going to jail and having to pay large fines. But for a very long time, it was like an invisible epidemic. And I, you know, became very concerned about it for this very personal reason.
What's the true life story of Dr. Smile? Who's the person?
Well, there's the story about an Indian-American pharmaceutical entrepreneur. In the novel, my character, Dr. Smile, is based in the Atlanta area, but the real person was elsewhere. He was sort of in the Chicago area. You know, he made a lot of money. He did very well. He had a good business. And he patented a variation of fentanyl, a very powerful opioid. But because he was, to put it bluntly, a little crooked, he started bribing doctors to prescribe this medication, as they say, off-license, which means for things it's not intended to be prescribed for, and therefore became a billionaire and contributed a great deal to the opioid epidemic. And then just recently, he was arrested and tried, and I think he's in jail now.
So you'd been investigating that, and suddenly that story came up in the actual headlines.
Yes, I mean, what's so weird is that literally in the month of this book coming out, suddenly it's a huge news story all over the headlines. And, you know, for the last several years that I've been thinking about it, I mean, people have talked about it a little bit, but it's been very much kind of under the radar, this epidemic. And the thing that I came to feel about it, you know, yes, there's all this stuff about crooked doctors and manufacturers, but I came to feel that in some way this is a manifestation of the growing isolation in which many of us live. Where it's most prevalent is in small towns in the middle of the country. And you feel that somehow we've constructed a society in which apparently we have a million ways to communicate with each other now, but actually we're all becoming more isolated from each other and lonelier. And this kind of thing, drug addiction, it starts off as a way of as a form of solace, and then it becomes addiction. So all of that was very interesting to me, and as I say, I've been thinking about this for a decade, and it's only now that I felt able to write about it.
Salman Rushdie, there are several different areas. You tackle several different areas in this book. One of the key areas, particularly early on in the book, as I was reading it, I kept going, he's written a book about the rise of fascism. And then, of course, it becomes plainer in the town of Beringer, which is based on Ionesco's rhinoceros.
Yes. Well, Ionesco's rhinoceros was about the rise of fascism.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah. And Beringer, the main character, was the last one who did not become a rhinoceros. Yeah. And in this case, you made a mastodons.
Yes, I just thought pink elephants, you know, would be funny.
At what point did you decide you would go on this little side trip about Ionesco?
Well, really for the reason that you say, because I began to feel that we're sort of there again, you know. And he wrote that in the aftermath of the mid-century, you know, rise of fascism, you know, Hitler and all that. What I thought is that what he's saying to us is that a moment can come in which the people who are our next-door neighbors can overnight become monsters. They can become so alien from us that we can't talk to them anymore, and they can't talk to us, and they're frightening. And I thought, well, that may be somewhere quite close to where we live right now. And so I actually inserted this chapter because it's like a self-contained little moment in the book where Quichotte and his half-imaginary teenage son, Sancho, take a detour off the road in order to spend the night somewhere before they drive into New York City, and suddenly find themselves in this surrealist milieu. And I put it in because I just thought, you know, it feels right to me to put it in, because I feel that it's as accurate now as it was when Ionesco wrote his play.
For me, it was interesting because last spring, ACT in San Francisco did a major production of Rhinoceros.
Oh, did they?
Yeah, and I interviewed the director, Frank Galati, from Chicago, and we talked specifically about the fact that Beringer, or Ionesco, was just watching his girlfriend. All of these intelligent people suddenly became someone else.
Yes.
They became the monsters.
Exactly.
So when I hit this, I'm going, oh, there it is.
Well, you see, when I was at Cambridge, age 19, I was cast in a production of Rhinoceros. And I wasn't the lead. I wasn't Beringer. I was one of the other townspeople. But I was one of the people who had to turn into rhinoceroses. And you had to keep running on and off stage. And every time you're off stage, somebody sticks a bit more rhinoceros on you. And then you come back on stage. And I remember at that age, that tender age, being puzzled. What's this about? You know, and I remember asking the director, you know, what's this about? It seems like nonsense. And then he gently and kindly explained to me that it was about Nazism. And I thought, oh, that's clever. And it made me think about how you can use surrealism, and as it was then called, absurdism, to say something deeply real about the real world. And I thought, I'd like that idea. And it was very, very a kind of shaping moment for the way in which I afterwards would think about writing.
And that then played a role in all of your books.
Yes.
That have a fantastic element.
Yes, yes. It was a kind of important moment for me as a young person thinking about wanting to be a writer.
There are other elements involving racism, in particular what happens when Quichotte and his son, quote-unquote, Sancho, wind up at various places and get accosted, and in one particular instance, almost shot. Yeah, one instance they do, and one instance the writer does. Is that based on any event that you saw?
Not that I saw, but that I knew about. And this brings us back to the imaginary town of Beautiful in Kansas. There's a real town in Kansas whose name I always mispronounce. I think it's pronounced Olathe, O-L-A-T-H-E. And a few years ago there was, you know, one of the random shootings that happens every day in America. Some crazy guy went into a bar, and there were two Indian Americans, I think software engineers, at the bar, and he shot them. And one of them died, and one of them survived. And I remember reading this and thinking how absolutely meaningless this was. You know, he just shot them because they were there. nobody said anything to anyone. There was no altercation. And so a version of that scene crops up in the novel. But because I didn't want to be limited, if you know what I mean, by the news story, I didn't want to put it in the real town. So I changed the name of the town because I discovered that the name of the town is actually a Native American word, which means beautiful. So I thought, okay, then I'll call the town Beautiful. And it'll be very close to the real town, but it won't actually be the real town. So I'm not limited by the news story.
You're listening to an interview with Salman Rushdie, whose latest book is Quichotte, a novel. I'm Richard Wolinsky. In Don Quixote, of course, there's also Sancho Panza, who's a real person. What made you decide that this Sancho would be an imaginary person who becomes sort of real?
Well, because I saw my Quixote as a lonely man, you know, somebody who'd never been married and always wanted a child. And so I thought his need to be a father would be a good way for the child to come into being, just out of his desperate need. He can will the child into being. And I felt that was what my character wanted to do, you know. I mean, I never wanted really to exactly mirror Don Quixote and Sancho Panza, you know. And in many ways, they grow quite unlike each other. As you say, Sancho Panza is a real person. He's an adult. He's very earthy. He's very kind of physical. And my character, Sancho, is a figment of Quixote's imagination, who gradually acquires a kind of reality during the course of the story. So they're very unlike each other. And Quixote himself differs from Don Quixote in that Don Quixote is characterized by being melancholy. You know, he's called the Knight of the Dolorous Countenance. He has a long, sad face. My character, from the first moment that I started writing about him, wanted to be very cheerful. You know, his real name is Mr. Smile, and he has a charming smile, and he has good manners of the old school, and beautiful handwriting, and he is absurdly optimistic and hopeful. So that even as he goes through America at what may not be the most hopeful moment in America's history, he retains a kind of sweetness and optimism about it. And then in his own quest for this talk show hostess that he's got obsessed by, which he calls falling in love with, he knows that he's absurdly out of her league, but he tells himself that it'll be fine, that if he can make himself worthy of her, love will find a way. And I wanted, to me, that those two things, the hopefulness of Quichotte and the determination of his imaginary son to be a real person, that those were the driving forces of the characters. And so, I mean, Sancho, my Sancho, actually has a closer relationship to Pinocchio than to Sancho Panza.
And there's Jiminy Cricket in the book, so.
Yes, there's Jiminy Cricket's Italian original, you know, because not in the Disney movie, but in the original novel Pinocchio by Carlo Collodi, there is a talking cricket, and he's called Grillo Parlante, which means talking cricket. And he speaks Italian. So I thought, I'm going to have the original cricket, not the Disney version. And of course, the cricket, as the cricket does in all those other examples, represents conscience, something in which Quichotte is very interested, because he's a person for whom morality is very important. But Sancho, his mutinous teenage child, is not really that interested in conscience. In fact, he says to the cricket that conscience doesn't really get you very far in the world as it is, you know. Lies, crookedness, treachery, all that seems to work. Conscience doesn't seem to. So his relationship with the cricket is less close, if you like, than Pinocchio's.
One other element that where it differs is that Quichotte is not really delusional. He knows every step of the way what he is doing. He knows he's obsessed. He knows that she probably, even though he would love to think her falling in love with him, he knows damn well it probably won't happen. And he knows that he's really Smile.
Yes, he does. He's not crazy. He's just a little bit cracked.
Once you created Sancho as his son, was that the point where you began to see that connection between the writer writing the book?
Yes, it was, in a way. Because, you know, for me, I really have always been very interested in love relationships which are not romantic love relationships. That's to say, in this novel, romantic love is represented by this obsession of Quichotte for Miss Selma R., the talk show host he's obsessed by. But these other love relationships, fathers and sons, brothers and sisters, I think in many ways are as central in our lives and much less talked about. So I wanted that to be at the heart of the book. And in my own case, personally, I've had, both as a father and as a son, I've had very different experiences. Like, my relationship with my father was bad for much of our lives. I mean, it was good when I was a little boy, and it was good again right at the end of his life. But for a lot of my adult life and a lot of his life, we were very much at odds with one another and alienated from one another. And I wanted very much to be a different kind of father and to have a different kind of relationship with my children. And I do have, so I have the experience of both a bad father-son relationship in which I was the son and a much better father-son relationship, or two of them, in which I'm the father. So that's always been something I've thought about a lot. So the two variations in the novel, the two fathers and sons, come out of very much my own personal interest in being a good father, in what it was like to be a son.
Salman Rushdie, the character of Salma R., whose mother and grandmother were also Bollywood actresses, I noticed something about reference back to Bombay from her, from the Smile family, and it reminded me a lot of you talking about what Bombay was like before you went off to England.
Yes. I've obviously fictionally visited it before, in Midnight's Children, in The Moor's Last Sigh, even in the last two books, in The Golden House and in 2 years, 8 months, 28 nights, there are moments back there. This time I've actually disguised it much less than in the past. I've actually used the real names of the neighborhood where I lived, the real names of the houses there, and in a way this is a real portrait of that vanishing world, because the city is not like that anymore. It's very different. And so it's that Bombay is nostalgic even to people who still live in what is now Mumbai. Quichotte and his author are both people of Indian origin living in America. They're both people with a kind of nostalgic fondness for those early days of their lives. And I guess I have that too. But I'm also well aware that that really is the past. And even if you were to go to that city, it wouldn't feel like that now.
Well, I think that's true these days of any place, including San Francisco, where you just look around and the skyline is suddenly completely different, or London for that matter.
Yes, exactly. Both those cities are changing at quite spectacular speed.
Some other elements in Quichotte, one of which is alternate universes and a character named Evil Scent, which is kind of obvious, but he's not necessarily evil either. What made you bring in that, or was it just a push underneath it to kind of acknowledge old-time science fiction?
There is that science fiction strand of the novel, and Evil Scent is the character at the center of that. But it's also that I wanted to say that a part of the thing that is revolutionizing reality at the moment is this extraordinary speed of technological transformation. Things that people believed 5 minutes ago were completely fictitious, complete the stuff of fantasy and science fiction, are now things that get mass-produced and you can buy them for $100. That speed of change, I wanted to have a strand of the novel which explored that. So the Evil Scent character is a scientist entrepreneur who believes that he has, or that his company is finding the technology which can link our Earth to other dimensions, to parallel Earths, and that it may be possible to travel between them. And he tells anybody who will listen that our Earth is in such bad trouble that it's going to come to an end sooner rather than later. And so he recommends that everybody invest in his company, because he offers them the possibility of escape and a new beginning. I wanted that theme in the book, that the world is changing so fast that it may be that the world that we are familiar with, that we think we know, is actually in a way ending, and some other thing is coming into being.
Salman Rushdie, changing the subject, I went to IMDb and it said that there's a TV series being developed, Midnight's Children?
That was true. Sadly, I think it's hit a rock. I don't think it's going to happen.
I don't know if I asked you about what it was like working on Curb Your Enthusiasm. Did you write your own copy on that?
There is no script.
Oh, really?
It's complete. It's not. When I say it's completely improvised, it means there is no written script. It's what would be called, I suppose, guided improv. That they'll sit you down at the table in a restaurant, as I did with Larry, and they will say, look, in this scene, here's what's supposed to happen, roughly speaking. We have to get from here to here. But how you do it is up to you.
Did they contact you and say, hey, we want you on the show?
Yes. I mean, I had met Larry David just a couple of times. I didn't know him at all well. And he got in touch through my agents, and then we exchanged phone numbers, and I spoke to him on the phone. He told me, he said, we're doing this, and do you want to be in it? And later, he admitted to me that they had no plan B.
No, I remember watching the show and going, oh, wait a second, I know that guy.
Yeah, I mean, they said, you know, if you had said no, we wouldn't have known what to do.
Salman Rushdie, all right, now you've got this. You have mentioned in the past that when I ask you what you're doing next, you say I haven't thought about it or anything, but it's clear that by the time a book comes out and is on the shelves, you're hard at work on the next one. Is that correct?
It has been true for a long time now, and it's not this time. I realized that I've been publishing a book every other year for about a dozen years now, and that's alarmingly prolific for me, because I'm somebody who has often taken 5 years, 4 years to write a book. This sort of novel every 2 years thing is, it's really different for me. I think that whatever that hot streak was, I have a terrible feeling it might just have run out, because at this moment, I'm not writing anything, and I really don't have a clear idea of what to write next. And so it's not possible that there can be another, you know, for there to be a book 2 years from now, I'd have to be well underway with it now. And I'm not. I think I have to take a break.
One final question regarding politics. What we're seeing now is pushback against authoritarian regimes, whether they be proto-authoritarian like Trump or Johnson, or actual authoritarian like in Turkey.
No, I believe in that pushback. And I think, you know, that's one of the reasons why I, too, like Quichotte, am at bottom an optimist. You know, and what I did with the character of Quichotte was to take my often unjustified optimism that simply won't go away and exaggerate it, make it crazy optimism. And so he, in a way, is an exaggeration of me. And, you know, you were asking about Larry David. I mean, Larry David said to me about the character that he plays that it's an enormous exaggeration of himself, that he is a bit like that, but the character is a zillion times more like that. And I think Quichotte is like that in the relationship to me. I think he's me enormously magnified.
You've been listening to an interview with Salman Rushdie, whose latest novel is Quichotte. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Arts Waves Hour. Coming up in the Arts Waves portion of the program, an interview with playwright Ricardo Perez Gonzales. Ricardo Perez Gonzales is a playwright. His play, Don't Eat the Mangoes, is having its world premiere through March 22nd at the Magic Theater in San Francisco. Ricardo Perez Gonzales is the author of several plays, including In the Fields Where They Lay, The Tender Peel, On the Grounds of Belonging, which we will be talking about, and has spent the last year working for Netflix on the show Designated Survivor. But first, let's start with Don't Eat the Mangoes. When the play opens, when the lights come up, what do we see?
You see El Comandante. You actually see my abuela's home in El Comandante. They based the set design on my grandmother's home. And the first thing you see are these three women convening. Ismelda, the older sister, Wicha, the younger sister, and Ginoel, the middle sister, who's pretty much me. And you see them gathering together to try to figure out whose turn is it to take care of the old man.
Where does Mother fit in?
So Mother is... Mommy, is dealing with cervical cancer for the second time. She is at chemo at the opening of the play, and she's been going to chemo because her tío Eric has been taking her so that the girls can focus on dealing with Papi. And what's interesting about Mommy's role in the play is, despite the fact that she's going through her own health issues, she is still expected to take care of Papi because that is her social position. That is the good, dutiful wife.
In some of the promotional material, it talks about secrets will be exposed. This is pretty common in theater, to have secrets exposed. Mm-hmm. When you're investigating a play like Don't Eat the Mangoes at the beginning, and you're figuring out who the characters are, I mean, that may not be the way you start. Maybe you start with a sentence. But at what point do you kind of go, okay, there are things which have to be revealed later?
That's a really great question. It depends on the play. This play, I knew what it was because of the story, and I knew who the characters were because of the story that's been passed down in my family. Most of the time, though, honestly, I'm terrible at plot. I love characters, I love their interactions, but when it comes to those secrets and revelations, I have to think really hard about what is it that is born of these characters that drives the secrets and drives the actual plot of the play. I have fellow writers who, the second you tell them, oh, I was ahead of the play, they want to go jump off a cliff because they haven't done their job. And I'm not so crazy about having secrets and making sure they're revealed perfectly. A, it's not necessarily my skill set. And B, I can't remember who it was said. It might have been Campbell who said there are, what, 23 stories that we just keep telling again and again and again. The point for me isn't, ooh, what can I hide from the audience? How can I manipulate them? The point for me is, are they enjoying going on the ride? Even if they figure out maybe what comes next, are they still engaged? Do they still care about these characters? Are they still going on this journey with me? And that, to me, when I think of what secret should I embed, is the more important question.
So you're not as worried if somebody figures it out?
No, not really. We had a really great talk back, and there's a bunch of secrets in the play. I don't want to be too specific, but I asked about one in particular. Everybody had a different answer about when they knew. And for some it was, well, I had a suspicion, but then it was confirmed, or I thought it was this, but then it turned out to be this. And a couple people were like, no, I had no clue until it was revealed. And for me, that's actually more interesting than trying to write Inception where, ooh, it was a dream all the time. What, you know?
Right. What brought you to the family story, and what brought you to adding the hurricane?
The family story is, it's quite personal, actually. I would be lying if I said it wasn't about my family. I would also kind of be lying if I said it was about my family. But the story itself is really about a legacy of trauma and a legacy of violence being passed down through generations. And the events of the play actually happened to my bisabuela, like my great-great-grandmother. And the violence that was enacted upon her was then passed down to my great-grandmother and my grandmother and my mother, and then finally to me. That's where the inspiration came from. It's a story that I've known my entire life. It's been part of the landscape of my nightmares. And so it just made sense to kind of exercise it through the medium of theater. And I wrote the first scene of this play maybe 10 years ago in kind of a fever rage, if you will. It just kind of came out, and it was 10 pages, you know, and then I put it in a drawer or in a file in my computer because nobody writes by hand anymore. And I didn't look at it for 6 years. And I had the opportunity through the Soul Project and Jacob Pedron to do a reading of it with David Menizabal, my director. And it was just before Hurricane Maria hit. So I was working on the play through the reading and kind of made it, you know, made it more than 10 pages, made it a full 90-minute play. And once Maria hit, there was no way that I couldn't include that element. The play is not about Hurricane Maria. The play is about, it's actually since the time that you probably read the summary, it's now no longer a hurricane, it's a tropical storm. Because the play is about so much that making it about Maria would kind of subsume everything else. But the reality of tropical storms, the reality of power outages, the reality of climate on the island and what it does to folks is still a major part of the play.
I was looking at hurricanes in Puerto Rico, and they came occasionally, but we've had three big ones, Maria, Irma, and Dorian, just in the past 3 years. So climate change is kind of doing its number on Puerto Rico. Have you been down there?
Yes. I used to, as a kid, I was born in a trailer park in Ames, Iowa. I lived in Nebraska, Virginia, California, New York for, you know, almost 20 years. But I would, as a kid, we would go back during the summers and see my abuelas. And since then, once I became an adult, I still go frequently to visit my cousin and my tío. And the last time I was there was last year. And the state of the island, I was actually, interestingly enough, I was supposed to fly out the day Hurricane Maria hit to go to Puerto Rico to do research for this play, actually, to continue writing this play. But last year, the last time I went, it's just, you know, you drive through the parts of the South still, and the road just kind of disappears in front of you, and because it's been washed away. The island is so hard hit economically. My tío was out of work for 2 years, and he's actually an actor, and we used to work at a radio station doing theatrical programming, and the radio station was destroyed. And he used to have work as a grocery bagger, and he couldn't go back to that because there was too much competition for work such as that. So there are all of these devastating ongoing impacts of Maria and of the financial coup, the junta, that has been implemented by the U.S. through PROMESA. All of these are reverberating through the economy, and unemployment is massive on the island.
Getting caught up in talking about American politics kind of takes us in a different direction. But of course, it's a subtext pretty much of a lot of work that's been going on in theater and film over the past 3 years, for sure. As a playwright writing several plays at once, because you never know which ones are going to go in what direction, how do you balance commentary about what's going on now with creating plays that will survive past the orange monster?
It's a really great question. In most of my plays, I don't aim to comment on anything, really. I try my best to write about real characters living in the real world, dealing with real issues. In the case of Puerto Rico, you can't not The political context of Puerto Rico being a colony of the U.S. is just part of people's lives. So in some ways, the play itself is an allegory for the paternalistic, abusive colonial relationship Puerto Rico has with the U.S. That's really not on the face of it. It's not, you know, a baked-in commentary. It's just the way it is. And I think that the rest of my work is obviously in conversation with our present moment, because I don't think you can make art that's not in conversation with the present moment, because it's just how people live. So that, for me, is how I balance it. I make it about what's going on, and part of what's going on is possibly the death of our democracy. Part of what's going on are the massive waves of climate change we're seeing. Part of what's going on are growing disparity between the rich and the poor. So those are all the circumstances of people's lives, our audience members, and the characters of my plays. I love agitprop. I love other people doing agitprop. I don't think I'm good at it because I'm so angry. And it's just, whenever I try it, people are like, oh, well, that was just, no.
Ricardo Perez Gonzales, how does a play open?
In a literal sense, a play opens once the audience makes their first connection with all of the elements that are put into the play. So that means the design elements, the lighting, the sounds, the characters. And for me, that is actually the creation of the play. A play doesn't really exist until it is received by an audience member. I firmly believe that. And I can write all I want, a director can direct all they want, and actors can play for each other all they want, but until an audience member experiences it with their senses, the play doesn't exist. Also, for me, a play opens with that first idea. So thinking of a different opening of the subject matter, opening of my inspiration is what actually first popped into my head when you asked that. The kind of flowering of a character or a scenario or a situation or a scene that wells up inside me and I realize, oh, this is a story that needs to be told.
You've spent the last, I guess, year or 2 years, whatever it was, working on the Netflix show Designated Survivor. How does techniques that you might have picked up in the writer's room influence you in the rewrites of a play like Don't Eat the Mangoes?
I feel like TV and playwriting are just kissing cousins. They're very related because you're just writing a lot of dialogue, really based in character. Master playwrights used to say, well, TV, characters don't change. It's you know, it's so static. And that's just not true, especially
well,
nowadays.
Days, yeah.
Yeah. Because you have these long arcs. Characters change at the speed they change in life because you just have more time with them. So those two things have really stood me in good stead for both forms. But one of the things that has really come to bear on my playwriting is TV, you don't get long monologues, you know? You get dialogue that snaps and moves and kind of crackles. And I've always been something of a rhythmic playwright, but I've also been somewhat of an overly lyrical playwright. I love me some purple prose, like Lorca and Tennessee Williams are big influences for me. But in TV, you really can't indulge because you don't get to add time, you know? And it's really helped me in my playwriting to really think about what is essential to tell this story. What does this character actually need to say in this moment? What keeps the story moving forward? And really streamlining my dialogue and making it sparkle in a way that it doesn't always or didn't always before I started writing for television.
You're listening to an interview with Ricardo Perez Gonzales, whose play Don't Eat the Mangoes, directed by David Mondesabal, is at the Magic Theater through March 22nd. For more information, you can go to magictheater.org. I'm Richard Wolinsky on Arts Waves. How long have you been working with David?
Years. So we actually went to college together, to university, undergrad, NYU Tisch. And I remember I would see him in the hallways and in the elevator. I would like say hello, and he was always just a little too cool for school, or so I thought. He's actually just kind of shy. So we never really connected at university, but then I was an actor and he was a costume designer, and we wound up working on the same show, Man of La Mancha. I was the priest in Man of La Mancha, and he was designing the costumes. And so we got to know each other then. I remember our fitting. He was fitting a jail suit on me, an inmate's costume, right? And we started talking, and I mentioned that I had also started writing plays, and he runs a theater company called the Movement Theater Company in New York City, an amazing company that really focuses on artists of color and uplifting artists and writers of color. So he invited me to do a little festival with them. This was in 2010, I want to say, a little garden festival. I wrote a short little 10-minute play, and ever since then, we've just kept working together. I went back to NYU Tisch for a master's degree in dramatic writing, and I had him direct my thesis play. And then he directed my play On the Grounds of Belonging at the Public when it went up at the Public Theater as part of Public Studio. And then he directed it again at Long Wharf. And he helped me develop this from the ground up, from those 10 pages, along with The Soul Project and Jacob Padron, and then here at The Virgin with Loretta. He's just been a constant in the development of a lot of my plays. He's an amazing director, an amazing dramaturgical director, and an amazing design eye.
I notice a lot of playwrights and directors, they all start out as actors. So through your travels through all of these different cities as you were growing up, when did the acting bug hit?
Oh, that is all thanks to Jeff Ray, I used to call him, my kind of drama teacher in high school, rest in peace. He really taught me what theater could be in terms of exploration of politics, for one, exploration of kind of the human condition. My father was a singer and was also an artist in some ways, who became an engineer. And so ever since I was a young kid, he always encouraged me to pursue the arts. So I would do like little school plays, and I always kind of had that bug in me. But it really solidified in high school with Jeff Ray kind of, and the drama club, really just showing me what theater can be, how it can be a family, how it can really change people's lives, how it can save people's lives sometimes.
How did playwriting come into that? Because eventually, of course, you became a playwright.
Absolutely. Ever since I was a little kid, I've loved writing. And I remember somebody telling me that you should keep your first passion as a hobby and make your second passion a career, so that you always have something that you love and enjoy that you're not worried about getting money from. So, you know, again, since I was a little kid, I would write stories about Greek mythology. And there was, I don't know if you remember the Odyssey and the Cyclops Polyphemus. Odysseus snuck onto his island, stole his sheep, blinded him. He was like, Odysseus was a jerk, you know? And I remember hearing that story as a kid and thinking, poor Cyclops, you know? And so I wrote a story from the Cyclops point of view about trying to find home after being blinded and trying to go back to the land of the Cyclops, you know? I've always been interested in stories of people on the outside, people who are trying to make their way home as well. So I had a career as an actor for a little bit, and I was doing a work of devised theater about September 11th. Everybody in the cast was in New York on that day. And so we did a piece that we all co-created about other cities throughout history and across the world that had burned. So we didn't do it directly about September 11th, but we used these other historical instances to connect to our own experience. And it went up at the New York Fringe, and it was a really lovely experience. It wasn't everything I wanted it to be. So the director approached me shortly thereafter, after we closed the show, because he wanted to do another devised piece about the World War I Christmas truce, where the British and Germans just stopped shooting at each other and sang Christmas carols across no man's land. And I remember sitting in his living room, Brad Raimondo, he looked at me and said, you know, do you want to do this? You're a really great actor and participant, collaborating in this. I want to do another devised piece. Will you do this? And I looked at him, I said, no, let me write it. I had never written a play before. I didn't know what possessed me in that moment, but I just, something made me ask. And I remember the look on his face. He just stopped for 2 seconds, kind of tilted his head and said, okay. And that was the first yes I ever got as a playwright, and it changed my life. Brad Raimondo, in that moment, I then wrote In Fields Where They Lay, based on the World War and Christmas truce. It got a fairly good New York Times review, which is, you know, for a first play, what more could you ask? That set down my trajectory.
Two areas that a lot of your work covers. One, of course, is your heritage as Puerto Rican. The other is gender, being a gay man. And that brings us to probably what you consider your magnum opus that you're still working on The Grounds of Belonging, is the first play in a trilogy. And it's about an interracial couple in Houston starting in the 50s. And the three plays, I guess, take place over a period of several decades. Mm-hmm. What brought you to that? And are you familiar with the bars of Houston?
That story actually begins like all good stories begin, with a boy. I was dating somebody in Los Angeles when I was there many years back, just kind of testing it out to see if I wanted to live there. And this gentleman Mooney Starr, he was a singer, had elders, gay elders, queer elders that, you know, like we all have. I think every gay man of a certain generation has older gay men who kind of mentored them and that they have a relationship with that they kind of took care of them and showed them what queer life could be like. So he had a couple of friends like that who actually went to these racially segregated gay bars. There were a pair of older African-American gentlemen who would go to the Gold Room, which was the blacks only bar, and or rather the African-American space, because white people could always go into quote unquote blacks only bars, but that the of course black people could not go into whites only bars. So I remember I was dating him and he mentioned this story and I was like, oh. And it was interesting because I wasn't overly surprised that there were racially segregated gay bars. I was a little surprised that there were gay bars in Houston, you know? And then in the 1950s, because everybody thinks queer history started at Stonewall. I was also really struck by, once I heard, you know, racially segregated gay bars in 1950s Houston, Texas, I was thinking about New York and LA in some ways. And I was thinking, oh, racially segregated gay bars in the 50s. Well, I guess there were racially segregated gay bars, but that makes sense because there still are. And you go to a lot of spaces and it's like it's a whites only bar. And then the drag queen makes a joke about the one black person there. And it's like, wow, that's a welcoming environment, right? And then in New York, there used to be No Parking, which was a Latine bar, and Secret and The Web, which catered to very specific demographics. And you only need to go on Grindr to see whites only signs, pretty much. It's an amazing moment in time, but it also resonates to this very day.
Ricardo Perez Gonzales, designated survivor, I guess that's the day job. How'd you get involved with Netflix?
I took a meeting. It was an amazing opportunity. I was in New York on a theater retreat, doing like yoga. I had my like soccer shorts and my tank tops and flip-flops in upstate New York in the woods doing theater games. And my agent called, actually my manager called and said, hey, there's a showrunner who wants to meet you this Friday in LA. It was Wednesday. It was Wednesday night he's calling me. I was just, I don't know if I can make it. The trip's going to be expensive. I'm on this theater retreat. I'd have to leave early. And I call my partner, and my partner's like, baby, go. And I ended the conversation with him saying, I'm probably not going to go. But that stuck with me, that he was so like, you really have to do this. This is what you want to do. And so that night, I booked a plane ticket. I flew out Thursday afternoon, got in Friday morning at like 1. I was still in my soccer shorts and my flip-flops, so I actually had to borrow clothing from a friend of mine in LA. I still love those shoes. I wish I could steal them from him. But I took this meeting with Neil Bayer, this amazing showrunner, amazing writer. He used to write on ER and was showrunner of Law & Order SVU and Under the Dome. We just kind of clicked. Like, I was able to look at, because I watched the entire series in that like 12 hours on the plane and getting there and then waiting for the meeting to start. And we just had very similar sensibilities about where we wanted the third and final season to go. And he kind of took a chance on me. He's a fellow queer writer and we're now still working together.
You've been listening to an interview with Ricardo Perez Gonzales, whose play Don't Eat the Mangoes is playing at the Magic Theater in San Francisco through March 22nd, 2020. For more information, you can go to magictheater.org. And if you want to watch his work on Designated Survivor, it is on Netflix. The complete interview can be heard as a Bay Area Theater podcast in the Area 941 section of kpfa.org starting this weekend. You can subscribe to both the Radio Wolinsky and Bay Area Theater podcast through your iTunes app. Coming up now, the weekly Artswaves Theater Review. Sitting in a cubicle in an office, no matter how great the job or its prospects, can be a debilitating experience. At least that's the way playwright Brandon Jacobs Jenkins saw his brief time working at the fabled New Yorker magazine several years ago. It's also true that TV shows like The Office in particular or of course several dozen other sitcoms, have covered cubicle life more fully than any two-hour play ever could, which is why Jacobs Jenkins goes so much deeper in the funny and shocking Gloria, a Pulitzer Prize finalist in 2014 and now a production at ACT Strand Theater through April 12th.
Gloria opens in the offices of a cultural department of a major New York City magazine.
Eric Ting, director of the production.
At the top of the play, there's a young intern making copies at a copier. One of the assistant editors is also there at the office on time. No one else is there yet. What starts to unfold is essentially a day in the life of this office.
One thing is very clear from Act One, that Brandon Jacobs Jenkins is a very funny writer. It's nonstop laughter as the four characters in adjoining cubicles complain and babble about their lives, their future, their disappointments, and of course, the stultifying role of management.
With Gloria, he's wrestling with the situational comedy office setting, an office comedy. That's what he asks you to sort of like come into it thinking that it's going to be. And then in the classic Brandon way, he subverts that very intentionally, and in this case, very suddenly, and in some cases, unexpectedly.
Gloria is one of those plays that takes a sudden turn at the end of Act One, an event for which there seems to be no foreshadowing, so it's a little hard to talk about themes except in the most general sense.
What is true when you go into working on a play by Brandon is that you're aware that there's the story that's happening on the surface, and then there's probably two or three layers of additional sort of stories unfolding underneath that.
It's hard to single out any of the six-member cast. Those special kudos go to the fast-talking Melanie Arlie Ma as the nonstop office gossip. And Lauren English is so different in her two roles that you really have to pinch yourself to remember it's the same actress. As with many plays in which the funny dialogue in Act One gives way to a more serious aftermath in Act Two, some audiences might feel let down. But that's part of the plan, because Gloria examines how the contour of our lives is often shaped by sudden events out of our control, and that a play may end, but our lives continue to go on. Gloria, by Brandon Jacobs Jenkins, directed by Eric Ting, plays at ACT's Strand Theater through April 12th. For more information, you can go to act-sf.org. I'm Richard Wolinsky on Bay Area Theater for KPFA. Tune in next Thursday for an interview with Lydia Yuknovich, whose acclaimed collection of short stories is titled Verge, along with a still-to-be-determined archive interview. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artswaves Hour.
Bylaws referendum is underway, and as a member, you have a right to vote on whether to replace the current bylaws with the proposed bylaws. Some proponents assert that drastic change is necessary in the face of steady financial decline and a significant loss of listenership at some stations. Some opponents claim there is a secret plan to sell off one or more stations, such as WBAI in New York, and use the proceeds to prop up the remaining stations. For more info, visit elections.pacifica.org or leave a message on 510-931-7504. Be sure to cast your ballot by 11:59 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on March 19th.
I'm Sonali Kolhatkar. I want to let you know that my show, Rising Up with Sonali, is now on in a new time slot every weekday from 3 to 4 p.m. on KPFA. Rising Up with Sonali is an award-winning, all-woman produced show bringing you fiercely progressive news coverage. And now you can get the day's news fresh from us every Monday through Friday at 3 p.m. right here on KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.com.